I just can't believe it. For the first time in my life, I'm actually using math professionally. What's up, guys? In this video, I want to show you how to use the expression selector in order to create text animations with After Effects and using some pretty scary looking equations. If that sounds interesting, let's get started. All right, so now I want to show you how you can start this from the beginning. We're going to need a new composition. I'm just using UHD 4K, 30 FPS, 150 frames. That's fine. And we'll need a text layer. So we'll just type in bounce. And in order to activate the text animator, you want to open up the text layer, go to animate, and you basically just pick an attribute that you want to animate. So in this case, I want to do position. And then I also want to do scale. So I want it to do some squash and stretch as well. So how this works is, by default with a text animator, you get a range selector. And the range selector works very similarly to how the stroke effects start end works. So for example, if we alter this position, so we can say this is basically the end position. So if we pull this all the way up here, this is where it's going to start. And then with the start here, if you animate the start, you'll get all the letters to come down in turn. Now the limitation with the range selector is you can't have all the letters follow through with multiple bounces. So to do that, we'll use an expression animator instead. You can use expression selectors with range selectors, but in this case, we're not going to. So we're just going to delete this range selector. So we're going to add an expression selector through here. So the next thing is open up your expression selector, and then we're going to add our expression to a mount. So hold down Alt and click the stopwatch. And then you can delete the expression that's currently there. So in the link in the description, there are two different links. So it's one for the expression itself, which is basically just a Google Doc with the text so you can copy paste. There's also an AEP file. So the AEP file is already set up for you, but if you want to know how to like implement this into one of your existing projects, it might be easier just to do some copying and pasting. So I'm just going to copy paste this. And in this layer, I'm just going to do Control V and paste in the expression. All right, so right away, we're hit with quite a few errors. And these errors are because I have all of these variables and it's saying that they're unknown. And they're unknown because I'm referencing a different layer. So you don't have to use what I have here. You can delete all of these lines and then just put in your own variables for these. But instead, if you wanted to be able to animate these variables instead of just having them static, or if you wanted just to have an easier way to control them, it's better to create a null object. Let's go up here to layer and go to null object, rename this to be animation control. In effects and presets, we're looking for a slider control, and we're gonna need 5 of these. So you can select this one, just duplicate it 4 times. And the way this is gonna work, you wanna rename the variables to be the same thing that you have down here. So you need to have your animation layer called animation control, and the effect is called speed. So up here, we click enter, and then we type in speed. And now this slider will work. So we can just go one by one through all of these and just make sure that whatever is in quotes for the effect slider name, that is positioned here. If you want to do it manually, I can show you how to do that as well. So here we're just going to type in index offset. All right, so after all of these are added and they're named exactly, you're not going to get any type of error, but your animation is not going to do anything because they're all zero. So the default values that I have in the file, I have 5 for speed. For index offset, I'll explain this in a moment, but you want to have this at a very large number if you don't want the individual letters to bounce. Start frame, this can literally be whatever you want, but just for the sake of this demo, I'll just say 10. The amplitude is going to be how high your bounces are, and this is going to be dependent on the size of your composition. So I have mine at 4K, so at 50 is a pretty good number. And then the decay rate is how quickly the bounces are going to stop. So in this case, 0.25 is pretty good, okay? Now if we scrub, we can see that we are getting a little bit of bounce. Now in order to increase that, come down here to the position. This doesn't start until frame 10. So if you go to frame 10, and then you increase this number to something like, or decrease it, the highest it goes is around there, so we can just have it go off the canvas. But before frame 10, the way this works is it's set to 0. So the expression that controls that is down here. So let's open this up and have a closer look. So this expression right here for the time divided by this comp dot frame duration, this is converting time code into frames. And then we can compare that with whatever our start frame is. So in this case, if we have it start at frame 10, before frame 10, this is returning the number 9. And is 9 greater than or equal to our start frame? Well, no, it's not. But as soon as we hit 10, then it can start. All right, if it's not, so the else part of this, if it's not, s just equals 0, and s is the variable I'm using to basically control what our position or scale attributes are down here. So if you wanted to have this start at frame 10 or whatever, but have it not be visible at its ending position, what you would need to do is just, you could add a new variable here if you wanted to, or you can just type in a number. But I wanted to show you how you could create a variable specifically for this. So what we could do here, go back up to the top, and underneath the K rate, we say basically start position. So you can define a new variable just simply by typing in a new word. So start position, set this equal to, and we're gonna set it equal to a new animation slider. So we'll need to go back to our animation control, grab a slider control, click enter, and we'll rename this to be start position. So start position is up here, and what we can do here, start position, we grab the pick whip, we attach it to the slider of slider position. You can put a semicolon there here, and if you want to add a comment, you can simply say something like Y value at start. And then all we have to do is come down here, and instead of setting S to 0, we'll just copy start position, and now S will equal whatever our start position is. We can let go of this, and if we go up to our start position here, and then just increase this value, then we'll get it to be off the screen at the very beginning. Okay, so moving on to the rest of this, right underneath the if statement, I basically have two variables. The first one, X. X is used inside this S variable, which is basically just a mathematical equation that we're graphing. Time is a function that returns a new number every frame that you go forward. And then since time is very, very small, and every time you go one frame forward, it's not much of an increase, I have a speed scaler just so you could speed that up. And then you subtract the index offset if you want all of your letters to bounce differently. So that's what X is. And inside S, we're going to be referencing variables that we have up here just to make this line very concise and not be much, much longer, because we have these variables here just so we don't have to put this comp.layer and all this line inside this equation. Just makes it kind of messy to read. So to explain this expression, I'm going to hop over to a site called Desmos. This is a JavaScript conversion of an expression I made. So let's go over to Desmos. And Desmos is a free graphing site, and it's very, very useful. So the equation I have here is y equals e to the negative x. And that's the main thing to make x get smaller and smaller and smaller. And then I multiply that by a cosine function. So I do cosine x times pi. So Desmos kind of saved my life when I was in calculus class, and even now I use it for the classes I'm in for some of the graphing stuff we have to do. This is a little bit hard to see. So what we're going to do, we're going to have that decay rate variable, which is what goes up here, and that's set at 0.25. That just allows the decay to be a little bit faster with each bounce. So hopefully when we zoom out here, this kind of looks like a graph editor in After Effects. So you can imagine this is the text going up and down. So with every bounce, it has less and less energy, and it's bouncing less and less and less until it's not bouncing anymore, essentially. So there's one other thing that we have to do here. We need to surround these in parentheses. And because it's going through the floor, we need to take the absolute value. So the absolute value is going to prevent any negative number. And actually, we're going to get a better animation curve here anyway, because we want it to be more linear as it hits. It can ease out of the bounce and then ease back into it falling. So that's going to give us a slightly nicer animation. And then at the very end, I have an amplitude variable. So the amplitude is whatever number is in front of this and multiplied by it. So if you did something like 10, then you zoom out here. So you can see that it's going to be quite high and then just drop off. You can also multiply this by a much smaller number and you'll have a much smaller amplitude. So this next part, I basically converted this into JavaScript. Let me go back here. This is that same equation, just using JavaScript. And instead of using a number here for amplitude, I just have the variable amplitude, which if we look on our animation control, amplitude is set to 50. So it's 50 times all of this. So after that returns a number, it's going to give you an array. So this array is basically your X and Y position. You can have a Z position as well if you wanted some kind of movement forward and backwards towards the camera with the Z axis. But in this case, with position and scale, I only have two attributes. So even if you did have another parameter here, you can just return a two variable array, and it's not going to make any difference. So the very last part here is this embedded if statement. All this says is, as this number, the bounce gets less and less and less to the point where it's barely bouncing at all, just stop the bouncing, because otherwise you'll always get a little bit of like micro jitter, and micro jitter is kind of annoying, and you might just want to make sure that you don't get that. In that case, I have this set. If you wanted to play around with this number, you can just change that, but I think this is going to be pretty reasonable for what we have. You definitely want to add motion blur to this, so make sure on bounce you have motion blur enabled and is enabled for the comp as well. And the only other thing that we have to do here is change the scale. So for the scale, we want to unlock the scale, and I'm actually going to turn off the motion blur temporarily here. Just go to one of the bounces. You can kind of really visualize this. So this range here basically indicates the maximum range this can go. So you would want to make sure you go kind of higher up on one of these bounces so you can see what you're doing. And then just increase this. So we could do something like 400%. So in order to maintain mass, both of these variables, when you add them together, need to equal 200. So right now we have 400. So if you add 100, you're getting 500 and you're not getting 200. So you have to subtract a value here in order. So when you increase this on the y-axis, you have to decrease it on the x-axis. In this case, we'll have to do negative 200. And then when we bounce up and down, we're maintaining mass as we do that. We'll turn motion blur back on and see what we have here. So what we've got here is everything bouncing together. Remember, if you want to be able to play around with the index offset, go up to your animation control and you can try something that's much smaller. So remember, the larger numbers mean that the letters are going to be grouped together more. So it's going to be like the whole words bouncing. But if you don't want that, you could just do something like one, and then you'll get all the letters to kind of bounce and turn. Something like this. You could do something like 10 and you're going to get something different. You can just scrub along this number and you'll just get different results. You want something a lot more subtle, you could even go up to something like 200, which towards the beginning, when it's much higher in the bounce, you're going to get kind of like a little wave going on, and it's going to soften out as you get further to the end. Alright guys, so there you have it. Math being applied to something that I would never have thought I'd use math for. So I've been doing math now for like 3 years or so. I'm studying computer science and it's basically just math. And one of the electives I'm doing now is like a telecommunications class, which is essentially just a bunch of graphing with different kinds of functions and like radio signals and that kind of stuff. And I thought, you could just use this for an animation. And lo and behold, yeah, it's really simple. So hope you guys learned something and you're not too afraid to dabble with expressions. This makes something that's very tedious not so tedious anymore. So I hope you guys learned something. If you did, drop a like. If you start playing around with these expressions, you have a question, just leave a comment. I'll get back to you. And I'll post another video going over maybe some kind of like demo of using this expression with something else. I hope you enjoyed it, and I'll see you next time. Peace.